Hare Krishna, we continue with chapter 2 of Bhagavad Gita as it is, contents of the Gita summarized. In this chapter, Arjuna submits to Lord Krishna as his disciple, and Krishna begins his teachings by explaining the fundamental distinction between the temporary material body and the eternal spiritual soul. Krishna explains the process for realizing this knowledge through selfless service to the Supreme and the characteristics of a person who has applied this knowledge successfully, the self-realized soul. Arjuna's misplaced compassion reduced him to a depressed, unwilling to perform his duty person. Seeing his friend in such a difficult situation, Krishna, of course, tried to cheer him up. He told him that such miserly weakness does not befit him, and it will lead to dishonor. Arjuna argued back, "This is not cowardice, but rather a proper judgment in consideration of the superior position of those worthy of worship like Bhishma and Drona, and an act of compassion towards those in equal positions, such as Duryodhana, who will die by the blow of my weapons." Krishna, however, was not impressed. "Do not fool yourself, Arjuna. This is neither correct judgment nor compassion. It is just a fleeting weakness of heart. Therefore, give up that weakness and prepare to fight. Do not become the laughing stock of the enemy." We may recall our reaction when a friend made a well-meant critical remark on a sensitive feature of our character. One of the most common responses is, "Fair enough, but what about you? You are the same." Arjuna's answer was similar. He argued that it is the general etiquette that superiors are not to be offered even a verbal fight. Even if they are sometimes harsh in behavior, they should not be harshly treated in response. Then, how is it possible for Arjuna to counterattack them? Would Krishna ever attack his own grandfather Ugrasena or his teacher Sandipani Muni? It sounds like a good argument, as well as all others before. There is one problem with all of them, however. They are not considering the supreme opinion of the supreme authority, the supreme personality of Godhead. As a result of following his own seemingly learned and elevated arguments, Arjuna became more and more confused until he finally realized his helpless bewilderment. He was utterly lost. His identity of a noble Kshatriya was gone, and thus he did not know anymore what is to be done and what is not to be done. Instead of succumbing to even deeper state of ignorance, however, Arjuna decided to surrender to Krishna and to accept him as his guru. This is an important moment because it signifies that even a great person like Arjuna cannot solve the problems of life without the help of the spiritual master. This shift in the relationship between Krishna and Arjuna, from friendship to discipleship, also signifies that absolute truth cannot be ascertained merely by friendly talks based on equality. Arjuna has asked Krishna to become his guru. Krishna immediately confirmed, and then, as a standard duty of a preceptor, he directly reprimanded his disciple. He spoke with a slight smile instead of laughing at Arjuna as a friend. Because since now Arjuna took the position of his disciple, such informal, friendly behavior will be inappropriate. Why did Krishna reprimand Arjuna? Arjuna's unwillingness to perform his duty of a warrior was disguised as a noble compassion. Krishna frankly told him that while speaking like a learned man, he is mourning for something that is not worthy of grief. Since the spirit soul can never die, Arjuna should not lament. None of the soldiers on both sides will actually be killed. Moreover, the bodies of Bhishma and Drona were already old. Arjuna actually should be rather happy that they will rejuvenate their energies. Arjuna agrees with this. However, he is still miserable due to the pangs of separation he will feel in the absence of his beloved elders. But these feelings of happiness and distress, points out Krishna, are due to the identification with the material body, and they are unavoidable as long as such identification persists. They follow one after another, just like the summer and winter seasons, and should not be the cause for rejecting one's duty. Arjuna should therefore tolerate them and fight. Before we continue, I'd like to explain briefly the Mayavad philosophy, because it will come up, the refutation of this philosophy will come up in the next verses. This philosophy, unfortunately, is immensely popular, and even the devotees struggle with certain aspects of it. In a summary, the Mayavadis propose that the absolute truth is ultimately impersonal, without name, form, qualities, or desires. Therefore, when God comes down to the material world as an avatara, his form is a material illusion in the mode of goodness, because ultimately God has no form. They claim that the ultimate goal of existence is, imagine, committing spiritual suicide by merging in this nameless and formless realm beyond all love and affection, where we can forget forever about the pains of our individual nature. The Mayavadis insist that our unique individuality, just as the individuality of God, is simply an illusion. They insist that in reality, we are all one with everything else. We are in fact all alone, because we are everything. We just have to realize that. One may wonder how come that such an appalling concept ever became so popular. One would expect its influence not to go outside of certain marginalized groups that embrace such philosophy because they were entirely frustrated in their attempts for happiness and therefore became resentful. Those bitter people who deny happiness and fulfillment simply because they were unable to secure it for themselves. The sour grapes, guys. But there is a simple answer to this mystery. The enormous popularity of the Mayavada doctrine lays in one of its basic claims. This claim, although absurd, or maybe precisely because it is absurd, resonates on the deepest level of our materialistic conditioned nature. It is the claim that we are all God. In one sense, this claim is true. However, although qualitatively identical with the Supreme, the soul is not quantitatively equal to him, just as the drop of the ocean has the same quality as the ocean, but it is not equal to the ocean in quantity. Moreover, if we are God, why are we suffering in the material world? So Krishna rejects the Mayavadi theory of monism and establishes that he and all living beings are eternally spiritual individuals. The separated existence of the living entities is not an illusion which dissipates in the state of liberation. Rather, it is their constitutional position. In other words, the soul is always subordinate to God. He can never become God, even when the soul attains perfection or liberation. The vision of the seers of the truth is that there is no endurance for the material body and there is no change for the soul. The soul is real because it is indestructible, unbreakable, immovable. That means the soul never changes its position of eternal spirit soul. Invisible and inconceivable. Those in knowledge know that the self neither slays nor is slain, and the change of body is equal to changing dresses. Arjuna, therefore, should not lament, because his beloved preceptors cannot be killed, nor their material bodies can be saved. The death rate is always 100%. Well, what if I don't believe in the existence of the eternal spirit soul? Somebody may exclaim. There is no reason for lamentation, even then. The cycle of birth and death is certain and applies to everyone. So many living beings are born and die at every moment. What is the use to grieve for them? No one laments for the loss of a certain bulk of chemicals of a negligible price. And nobody stops discharging his prescribed duty because of that. The fact that Krishna brings in such arguments shows that there were people back at least 5,000 years ago who did not believe in the existence of the spirit soul. Thus, it becomes clear that the atheistic propaganda is not a unique feature of our postmodern age. To reject the scriptures and to replace them with speculative theories which justify sense enjoyment is neither innovative nor admirable. In describing the immortal soul in various ways, Lord Krishna thus establishes that the soul is immortal and the body is temporary. Therefore, Arjuna as a Kshatriya should not abandon his duty out of fear that his grandfather and teacher will die in the battle. On the authority of Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Supreme Authority, one has to accept that there is a soul which is different from the material body. Not that there is no such thing as a soul, or that living symptoms develop at a certain stage of material maturity, resulting from the interaction of chemicals. This is the materialistic concept of evolution. Though the soul is immortal, violence is not encouraged. But at the same time, at the time of war, violence is not discouraged when there is actual need for it. That need must be justified in terms of the sanction of the Lord and not whimsically. We may recall from the previous chapter that Arjuna refused to fight because even if he wins, he would not be able to enjoy the kingdom without his kinsmen. Now Krishna defeats this argument. On the contrary, Arjuna should fight because it is the best way to secure his enjoyment. How is that? By dying in the battle, he would attain the heavenly planets, and by conquering the enemy, he would win the kingdom. So it is win-win. On the other hand, if he abandons the battle, he would incur sin by neglecting his kshatriya duty, and he would lose his prestige. The great generals will conclude, undoubtedly, that he ran from the battlefield out of fear, not because of noble reasons, and this will be most painful for him as a kshatriya. This is because for a respectable person, dishonor is worse than that. Therefore, Arjuna should stand with determination and fight. In this way, Krishna shows that opulence and sense enjoyment come from proper performance of our duties and not from discarding them. Arjuna gave four reasons why he should not fight. He felt compassion for his relatives. He thought that he cannot enjoy life even if he wins the battle. He feared sinful reaction as a result of fighting against his superiors. And he feared that the war will destroy the pious family tradition. As a result of these four reasons, Arjuna was undecisive. He did not know what to do. He was completely bewildered. Krishna already rejected Arjuna's sentimental compassion for the bodies of his relatives, and he also rejected the argument based on sense enjoyment. Now Krishna will address Arjuna's doubt that fighting will bring about sinful reactions. Krishna says that if Arjuna fights simply for the sake of fighting, because fighting is his duty, without considering happiness or distress, loss or gain, victory or defeat, he will never incur sin. In other words, sin results from fighting in ignorance. Fighting in knowledge, according to religious principles, is not sinful, but righteous. The analytical description of the soul, made in the beginning of the chapter, did not remove Arjuna's illusion. And this is not surprising. We have accumulated so much impurity in our heart that it is almost impossible to start acting on a spiritual platform just by hearing that we are spirit soul. Therefore, Krishna now recommends the process of Buddhi Yoga. Working in knowledge without attachment for the results. By following this process of Buddha Yoga, one is freed from karmic reactions and then he can realize his spiritual position. So if the knowledge doesn't appear, doesn't get realized spontaneously, just by hearing, then one has to follow the process of Buddha Yoga. And then he will realize this knowledge. This path of Buddha Yoga, Krishna continues, is so potent that even the slightest progress on it is never lost. And by such little progress, one can be saved from the greatest danger, which is to fall down from the human form of life back to the animal kingdom. Therefore, one should be firmly fixed in following Buddha Yoga with discipline and one-pointed concentration. This is the price for the success. In the above paragraph, Krishna stated that one should follow the Buddha Yoga with discipline. Those who think that such approach is too fanatical are not fixed in spiritual life and are diverted by many branched fruitive desires. Such less intelligent people who are attached to the flowery words of the Vedas say that there is nothing more than heavenly enjoyment. That they say that this is the goal of the Vedas and this is the highest purpose of life, to enjoy in heaven. Thus they are bewildered and bereft of the resolute determination for Krishna's devotional service. Such people, they are the proof that the religion or philosophy one follows is predestined by the disposition of his heart. Or as Arthur Schopenhauer wrote, our passions become the axioms of our philosophies. Thus all non-theistic concepts are simply attempts to justify different grades of impiety. They are not born out of an objective search for the absolute truth, as we are told, because any sincere quest for the absolute truth must lead to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And this brings us to an important point. The unity of science and religion, they are supposed to be unified. One process, the science, is to find the root of the tree, and the other is to water the root. This is the example Srila Prabhupada gives. So the real student of science should be able to find the root of the material world, the Supreme, Krishna, and then, in perfect knowledge, he should engage himself in the service of the Supreme. The Vedas mainly deal with the subject of the three modes of nature, continues Krishna. Arjuna should rise above this and be situated in the self without the dualities of desire and hate. Arjuna should not be anxious to protect his acquisitions and should not be greedy to amass more than necessary. In order to rise above materialism, however, Arjuna should not prematurely abandon his kshatriya duties. Krishna tells directly Arjuna that Arjuna's specific qualification or adhikar is not to renounce his obligations, but to perform them with proper understanding. In other words, Arjuna is not ready to act on purely spiritual platform, like a peaceful ascetic living in a cave in the Himalaya. If he does this, he will be frustrated because by nature he is an active person, a great warrior. Therefore, Arjuna is advised to combine knowledge and action and to fight as a matter of duty, without attachment for the result, in complete equanimity. Thus, striving for yoga, which is the art of working without karmic reactions, this is the real definition of yoga. Arjuna should act in God consciousness, in consciousness of Krishna. Many great sages freed themselves from birth and death by this process of Buddha Yoga and reached the destination where there are no sufferings. In order to attain the same result, Arjuna should not become bewildered by the heavenly delights promised in the Vedas, and he should become indifferent to karmic rewards and be fixed in transcendence. Having heard how Krishna began describing the stage of divine consciousness, Arjuna wanted to know about the symptoms of one who has achieved such position. So Arjuna asked, how does such person speak and what his language is? How does he sit and how does he walk? We almost expect to hear, in addition, what kind of t-shirt and sunglasses he wears, but Arjuna's question actually have a deeper meaning. Arjuna wants to know what the self-realized sage will say in the face of happiness or distress, respect or disrespect, praise or condemnation. He wants to know how he is able to restrain himself from worldly activities. And when he wants to engage in activities, how he engages his senses. Krishna answers that the main symptom of a person in divine consciousness is that he is detached from sense gratification, and all his needs, material, emotional, spiritual, are fulfilled by his spiritual practice alone. One may be on a certain relatively high level of spiritual advancement, but if he still thinks that, at least in some regards, matter can make him happy, in other words, he doesn't believe that all of his needs will be fulfilled just by his spiritual practice. So if he doesn't believe this, he is still in illusion. And in Srimad Bhagavatam, he is compared to a person who dreams that he is awake, although he is still asleep. So this is our situation. This is our position. If we still believe that matter can make us happy, at least in certain ways. We all want to be happy, but in our material condition, we are under the delusion that matter and materialistic relationships will provide us with happiness. The saintly person has realized that this is simply not the case. This is not true. Only spiritual things can satisfy the spirit soul. The soul needs material enjoyment as much as the fish needs a bicycle, following the famous analogy. The saintly person is not disturbed by the onslaught of the material miseries. We continue with the symptoms of the saintly, self-realized soul. He is indifferent to attachment, fear, and anger. Even if such negative emotions appear, they do not influence him. But how is this possible? How he can control the material desires? They are so strong. The senses are compared to poisonous snakes. The answer is very simple. The saint, the self-realized soul, actually enjoys doing this, controlling the senses. Why? He's able to control his senses according to his plan because he has acquired a higher spiritual taste, the taste of Krishna consciousness, the taste for kirtan, for listening about Krishna, for association with devotees, for Krishna prasaram. This taste, this higher spiritual taste, keeps him free from material enjoyment because he is completely satisfied. Krishna warns Arjuna that if he prematurely renounces his duties and tries to control the senses by force without acquiring higher taste, he will fall down. The senses and the mind actually cannot be controlled by force. The mind controls the senses and the mind is controlled by something more subtle than the mind itself. It is controlled by our desires. Therefore, the only way to control the mind is by purifying our desires, and this can be accomplished only when the mind is engaged in devotional service to Krishna. What will happen if we try to control our senses by force without engaging them in devotional service to the Lord? The result of such forced meditation is that the senses will inevitably find their way back to the sense objects. Krishna describes this process in detail. For the yogi who repeatedly contemplates sense objects, thinking that he will derive pleasure from them, attachment to those objects arises. Because of that attachment, thirst for pleasure, asat trishna, thirst for pleasure from those objects arises. When that longing is obstructed by something or somebody, anger, a burning in the heart arises to counteract the obstacle. From anger, complete delusion arises, and from delusion comes bewilderment of memory. This means that the aspiring transcendentalist forgets all good instructions which he has received from his guru. When memory is bewildered, intelligence is lost. And when intelligence is lost, one falls down again into the material pool. The devotee of Krishna is not afraid to act with his senses because he knows how to engage everything in Krishna's service. Those, however, who are without knowledge of Krishna consciousness artificially try to avoid material objects. And as a result, although they desire liberation from material bondage, they do not attain to the perfect stage of renunciation. They cannot enjoy life due to their artificial renunciation, so they don't enjoy Mahaprasaram, Kirtan, association with devotees. And for this reason, every slight agitation of the mind pulls them down again into the pool of material existence. And we see so many examples with great yogis which exemplify the same problem. For example, the famous story of Durvasa and Menaka. Excuse me, Durvasa Muni. Vishwamitra Muni and Menaka. On the other hand, the saintly person knows how to use everything in the service of the Lord. Therefore, he does not become a victim of material consciousness. Thus, he is free from the dualities of material enjoyment and renunciation because he acts on behalf of Krishna. He is satisfied in spiritual life and he is fixed in the Lord. The saintly person is internally renounced, but externally he is very active in devotional service. He does not have selfish desires and is free from false ego, and still he is very active because he wants to please the Lord. One is never bewildered after attaining such a position in spiritual life, and even at the hour of death, one who is thus situated reaches Sri Krishna's supreme abode. So you have it right here. A non-sectarian criteria for a genuine saintly person, regardless of his belonging to a particular faith. What is this criteria? He has pure desires and derives happiness only in devotional service. He is not disturbed by happiness and distress, and he controls his senses by being firmly fixed in the Lord's service. So, in this second chapter, Arjuna surrendered to Krishna because he could not find solution to his existential crisis. He was compassionate to his relatives on the opposite side of the battlefield, and he could not understand how he will ever be happy by killing them. Krishna answered that Arjuna's compassion was misplaced because the soul is eternal and can never be killed by any weapon. If Arjuna wants to attain happiness in life, he should perform his duty and not run from the battle like a coward. After seeing that his words did not dispel Arjuna's illusion, Krishna gave him a practical method for realizing the eternal nature of the soul, Buddhi Yoga. This is detached work in perfect knowledge of the Supreme. This is the method. And Krishna explained the symptoms of those who have attained such realization following this method. The second chapter revealed the real nature of the soul. In the next chapters, Krishna will explain more about the method to realize this nature by detached worker.